All set, Sector 1.
All 14 clear.
Okay.
Everybody out, passenger sight!
The status quo has gone on long enough. It's time for a new way forward.
What Rick does is he takes what could be construed as genre movies, and he does so much research and brings so much texture that they not only embrace the particular genre, but then they go beyond and acquire this unlikely authenticity, even though the situations are incredibly extreme.
Rick is just really thorough. He's very collaborative, really considerate.
You know, what's great about Rick is he could do every job on the set. He could run every department. He's grown up on movie sets. His dad was a stunt guy, and he's the consummate, Rick is the consummate director general who he anticipates what's potentially going to go wrong before it does.
It's in his DNA, movie making. His whole family have been in movies for a long time, so he knows every element of making a movie. You know, he's a cameraman, he worked in stunts, he's a director now, but he also knows special effects. He does everything. And so he gets the best heads of department in every field, from design to cinematography, and then he pushes them, says, bring me more, make it better, go, go, go. He really pushes everybody.
And he's really interested in authenticity and detail and things. He likes things to kind of work visually and for you to be able to suspend disbelief quite quickly.
My job is to make it as authentic as possible. And the very first thing that I do is I create a tremendous amount of research material, from lookbooks to real research papers, a collage of things that show what I want this movie to feel and look like. And so Russell De Rosario was my production designer, and I love him to death because he is a research hound like I am.
For me, this started with what was supposed to be, I guess, a 5-minute conversation with the director over Skype, and it ended in hours and hours of, largely me whittering on, him being kind of structured and thoughtful.
And by the time I arrive in London, I had already talked to him on the phone, and we had Skyped and went through everything, and I land, and I'm like, okay, let's get everything. He goes, oh, I already did it all.
This is almost like sifting a few little pages into history, like, what if this happened, and how would it happen if that worked?
Oh, today, I'm feeling presidential.
And what we've done is try to draw on quite real elements, so we're not a massive mental block away. We're quite close, and that's what's been attractive about this kind of using authenticity as a veneer to be able to tell a quite complicated story in some ways, but that has this kind of simple mechanics to it.
And literally had this most in-depth look at the Secret Service, the private contracting world, the different regions that the story would take place. And when you start in that type of passionate authenticity, then it has a ripple effect through everybody. And that's my job, is to inundate them with as much information as possible so that we can take the Queen's Lake in London, England. Literally, that was Virginia water that we shot at. The Queen rides her bike around that lake, and we happened to blow up a few things on it. Have the attack happen there.
Rick wanted for it to have cachet and for it to be interesting and dynamic, and also feel like it's part of modern society. And there's a really, really interesting developments in drone technology. I suppose that's a bit of a callous way of putting it, but when he was looking at how that works.
We had started doing a lot of research about drones, and look, I mean, it's no secret that law enforcement and our military are using drones, and so is the enemy, you know, and it's become a new type of warfare that is scaring both sides.
The further you look into it, if you look at like TED lectures, and if you look at 60 Minutes, and we looked at loads of different things, it suddenly became obvious that, you know, in the next generation of things, it can be really, really acutely capable through a kind of remote system. So we then developed these ideas of what these drones would look like and how they would work. But they would be kind of semi-sentient things that would have a bit of artificial intelligence to them and a bit of, you know, human kind of unintelligence.
You know, when you start the design of a movie, it starts with the production designer and then it filters into the different departments. And one of the most important parts of setting a look for authenticity is not only in your set design, but it's in your costumes as well.
Has this ever been washed?
They become the DNA, the skin of the character.
I always think of wardrobe as the icing. You make a cake, there's your script, there's your character, these are the words, these are the situations, now what do you look like?
As the costume designer, there's sort of a process that we all tend to use. You're obviously reading the script first, breaking it down, sort of getting a feel for the characters and how their story, because this is the third in a trilogy, how their story is developing, so that might affect the way they dress now. Jerry's been through, you know, two other movies and maybe it's changed him and therefore he would maybe look at life slightly differently and dress a bit differently.
Stephanie Colley is just a tremendous costume designer and really worked closely with Russell De Rosario, the production designer, and I in making sure that everybody felt very authentic. For the first time you see how the Secret Service is really outfitted, that they're all not wearing suits. They don't talk into their wrist. I mean, why the hell would you talk into your wrist when you're taking your hand that far away from your gun? You know, their mics are on their lapels. They're somewhere very close that their hands can be used for weapons, grabbing, and for protection.
Hey, can you give me a push?
Roger, I'm on my way.
So we wanted the wardrobe to match that.
Quite often we need unusual things, and I think on this one, it's a lot of military stuff, which is always fun to try and get hold of, and the helmets. And it's very interesting when you start researching and going to the actual companies. There's a helmet Jerry wears, which is from a very big American military company. And so it's really interesting, I think, to be able to actually use the real stuff that these real guys are wearing in these situations. I think it's really important to make it be as real as possible, and that's particularly what Rick wants.
Never once did we want the movie to feel like this tell-all book about the Secret Service. We wanted to give you enough of an essence of what they do that it felt like a day in the life of their world, with just enough authenticity that even the Secret Service themselves go, yeah, that's how we are. Now, we might fudge some things, and we do it on purpose to keep their tactics away from the enemy, so to speak. But we hopefully have given you enough of everybody's DNA, the way that the FBI would look, the way that somebody like Clay Banning would look out in the middle of the woods and how he'd be dressed, what his cabin would look like, how he would survive. We think about all these things.
So you run off your own power source, water and everything?
Sure, why not? You stay attached to their tentacles, they own you for life.
And this person that's at odds with everything, but that is calculating and methodical and a bit mad, you know. And so we've got him a really interesting Chevy. Ben and the car guys have got him this great car, and then my guys over in Sofia are building this amazing cabin out in the backwoods, and it's a sort of pretty much a real cabin. And so it has the low-tech version of everything that's everyone that's high-tech.
I told you they'd turn on you.
You know, stop. Just stop with all your big brother shit. Okay, your country didn't betray you. You betrayed yourself.
What the fuck do you know about it? I struggled all my life with this.
What struggle? You gave up!
We just had so much fun sort of playing around with different ideas for his look. I mean, we felt, you know, he's slightly hermit-like, living in the woods, sort of a bit of a woodsman type look. So we had to try on lots of sort of checks and sort of hunting jackets and things like that. And I think we're very happy with how he's ended up.
I was kind of told about the project by my agent at WME, and Rick, the director, and I shared the same kind of agency, so the agents, I think, were talking. And
we had to search for a DP, and the producers had just worked with Jules O'Loughlin on Hitman's Bodyguard.
Jules has a great body of work. I loved Hitman's Bodyguard, and he's a great guy and very on point with Rick's vision in stripping this down and giving it a kind of really truthful, gritty feel.
The first discussions about the film were, I guess in a way, a little about the previous two films, and that Rick didn't want to do what the previous two films had done. So I guess the word reboot was used a lot.
when you're trying to make another installment of a franchise, but you don't want it to look or feel like a sequel, you try not to study the other two movies that closely. Have I seen the other two movies? Multiple times. But never did I look at them in a way that I wanted to mimic or mirror what they had done. I really wanted the freedom in my own mind of shooting this movie as true to my vision as possible.
And it was kind of a tonal, visual reboot.
First of all, he shoots fast. He shoots multiple cameras, which I love at once, because I love the fact that he gets close-ups at the same time with actors, because I find that some, you're on one person's close-up and behind the camera, that person is killing it, you know, the other actor that is acting opposite of them.
I need to see the president. I need to speak to the president now!
Not gonna happen.
Even the way Rick shoots his close-ups, there's this kind of wide-eyed lens that kind of stretches your face, but it almost makes the scenes more hard-hitting or poignant. I don't know, but I never used those lenses before with other directors, but I just it gave the film an immediacy. Yeah.
And what was great about Jerry Butler is that's what he wanted and went for it with me. Never once did we go, well, you know, we kind of shot it this way in London, or we kind of shot it this way in Olympus. We would reference story points. We would reference the Banning and Trumbull relationship, or Mike and Leah, and the evolution of storylines. But never would we talk about how they were filmed or trying to capture these maybe symbolic moments of the movies, for example, in Olympus, of the American flag falling, you know, down below the White House. It's an amazing image that Antoine Fuqua shot. But never once was I going to try to mimic what he did.
His films have to be real world. And so that was the driving force of our initial discussions about Angela's Fallen, was that he wanted to shift tonally away from the previous two films, and he wanted to imbibe them with a real sense of the real world.
It was really about having the confidence, for better or for worse, but shooting it my version, you know, giving them what they wanted, which is me to put my stamp on it.